Hi there, welcome to Tercen. Today we'll continue our series on flow cytometry by examining how dimension reduction techniques are key to exploring your data. In data analysis, humans find it easy to work with two or three dimensional models. But in flow cytometry, where every signal channel represents a dimension, we quickly get to 20, 30, or even 50 dimensions, which are impossible to graph or even conceive in our imaginations. To handle this high-dimensional problem, statisticians have designed mathematical techniques to reduce the data in a structured way. These techniques work by calculating projections in order to remove redundant information from a high-dimensional dataset and reduce it to a smaller number of dimensions that can be graphed, so that patterns can be observed. For a long time, PCA was the preferred method to perform dimension reduction. It's well known, having been around since 1901, and is still robust for many uses. But it does not perform particularly well in the case of flow cytometry, because of the way populations are distributed in a signal channel. To meet this challenge, some new algorithms have been developed, TISNI in 2008, and more recently UMAP in 2018. The reason TISNI and UMAP are preferred for flow cytometry is because they use a non-linear projection technique, unlike PCA, which calculates in straight lines. The examples in these slides reduce from two dimensions to one dimension. This graph shows how a linear reduction technique like PCA draws a projection through the data where it's most variable. It reduces the data to a single dimension, which retains the information that's the most interesting to us, that is, the separation of the populations from each other. But PCA's linear reduction technique becomes problematic when confronted with populations which clump closely together, as they do in cytometry. In this example, PCA is not able to separate the populations that take a spiral formation. For this, we need modern techniques such as TISNI and UMAP that are non-linear. Non-linear techniques are capable of calculating curved representations of the data variation, which can have closely aligned populations projected onto them without overlapping. It's important to remember that dimension reduction techniques create a representation of your data, but it's not your actual data. Your data has been changed in order to reduce the high dimensions into something a human can visualize, and these changes bring a loss of information. While the algorithms are designed to keep as much important information as they can, they're not perfect. The advantage of nonlinear calculations is that they're better at maintaining the structure of the data as they reduce the dimensions. Therefore, they're better at making visualizations so humans can spot correlations. Let's go to the Tercen system, where we can look at this in more detail. Nikolai Oskolkov, a bioinformatician at the SciLife lab in Sweden, created an experiment that demonstrates this wonderfully. We have recreated a version of his experiment in Tercen to illustrate this data deformation and show why UMAP is the preferred non-linear way to perform dimension reduction. Here we've plotted latitude and longitude data points into a graph to make a map of the world. Consider the continents as the populations we're interested in. And for our example, we're going to reduce from two dimensions to two dimensions, just to show how data is deformed by these techniques. The relationship of the dots to each other is what is called the local structure of the data. And the relationship of the populations, the continents, to each other is what's called the global structure. By performing dimension reduction, both of these are going to change, but the question is, by how much? In this workflow, we've performed both TISNI and UMAP reduction. If we look at the TISNI first, we see that it's done a good job of keeping the population separated, and their local structure, the continent shape, is mostly preserved. But some of the continents have changed position relative to each other. This means the global structure has not been maintained so well. See that Antarctica, in red, has changed completely in both position and shape. UMAP, on the other hand, maintains the local structure of the data at least as well as TISNI does, but performs much better at maintaining the global structure. Despite being flipped upside down, you can see that continents are all recognisably closer to their real positions relative to each other. Now let's take a look at how this works with cytometry data. For this workflow, we used the PBMC dataset from Kirsten Diggins' research in the Jonathan Irish lab at Vanderbilt University. It shows different cell populations with high dimensions to be reduced. We can see how TISNI has done quite well here. Take note of the CD4 and CD8 T cell populations so we can compare to the other graphs. UMAP, we see, is giving better separation of the populations and is doing better at preserving their global structure in relation to each other. Just for comparison, we added a PCA reduction, which you can see doesn't perform very well. It struggles to get the T-cell population separated. This is why the cytometry community regards UMAP as the best dimension reduction technique currently available. The other techniques have their advantages in different scenarios, and you can check out some of our YouTube videos where we go into this a little bit. Next in this series, we'll discuss clustering. Thanks for watching.